We all have our antennas up right now about the future, and we realize we're heading into a very troublesome time. Is there any sovereign remedy for all the troubles that we realize will soon be upon us in this world? The answer is yes, there is. And that is to simply feel how we really feel right now. Not how we believe we feel, how we really feel. Because how we really feel right now is perfect, flawless, completely free of any sense of trouble or suffering or misery. And it is not affected by any circumstance whatsoever. Remains the way that it is constantly, seamlessly. Therefore, no matter what happens in the future, we will be unaffected by it. This is the true sovereign remedy for all the troubles. We don't dare try to navigate the troubles of the future through belief. We will be absolutely torn to pieces by it. And belief knows this. That's the whole purpose of going through these troubles. Belief is trying to get us to go through these troubles by using the navigational tool of belief, by using the advice of belief. It's amazing how we've been this cocoon of belief. And all our prayers, all our guidance, etc., is simply coming from belief. We have not yet been willing to step beyond belief to that which is here right now, instead of projected into the future, where belief resides, as it were, where our belief believes it resides. Because belief believes in process, in becoming, in getting better, in becoming more, in transcending, in all of this. And it never resides in right now. What is really true right now, that is what is. It is identity, it is reality, it is truth. And yet we don't feel that. And all this guidance we pray for, is really we're praying to belief. Or asking what to believe in. We want something to believe in. How many people do you know they want something to believe in, right? Very common. But what we want to do is we want to step out of belief, out of the future, into right now. The now moment, not the future, right now, how we really feel right now, not how we believe we feel. Belief is blind. Belief is blind. It doesn't know how we really feel. It simply tells us how we should feel based on the objectives of belief. Okay, and the objectives of belief are very nasty. It's really an attempt to generate a threat to reality through believing in destruction and loss, death, devastation, believing in all of that and acting that out in belief. So as to try and get greater belief in it, as if greater belief is going to bring about success of this plan to try and threaten reality. It's all stemming from our desire to be prime creator, and therefore needing some way to force the prime creator to create, to change reality so we can be prime creator. Therefore, we need to find a way to threaten the prime creator, threaten reality, so it forces this change to take place. So we believe it's possible. All we can do is believe it's possible. It's not possible right now. It's actually impossible. But we believe it will become possible. And so as long as we're following the guidance of belief, we will find ourselves enmeshed in very horrible circumstances. No matter who we think we are, we may know that we are the isness, unchanging isness, the true identity. We are reality. We are one. We are unconditional love. We may know this, but as long as we are giving this moment, present moment, to belief, we will be enmeshed in terrible suffering. So you may think you're very spiritual, and you could have spent a lifetime of spirituality and yet still be enmeshed in horrible suffering and misery. Because as long as we give this moment, present moment, to belief, that is what will happen to us. And we may think, belief tells us, it continually deceives us. It is the great deceiver. We may be very spiritual and had actually contact with the present moment, with the I Am presence of isness, with unconditional love. And then we turn the moment back over to belief, and belief will praise us and say, oh, you're so spiritual, you're so wonderful, you're so great. Okay, and belief will tell you to believe in that. It says, you got to believe in what you are. You got to believe it. And so here you are spending all this time believing in reality, believing in isness, believing in unconditional love, instead of abiding in it. And as you're spending all this time believing in it, you actually end up getting manipulated into terrible situations by belief. Believing in reality is the booby prize. Believing in truth, believing in isness, believing in oneness, believing in all that that is, believing in isness, that's the booby prize. That's to be avoided at all costs. And yet belief will trick us into that. And tricks almost everybody. Constant deception, self-deception. Believing in it isn't abiding in it. Belief cannot abide in truth and isness. It's not possible, because the premise of belief is that reality is not permanent. It's changeable. It was going to change. So it can never see it as it is. Belief can never see reality as it is, because reality cannot change. It's unchangeable. That seeing it as it is, you would see it's unchangeable. If you do see that, then belief will say, congratulations, you now have something very powerful to believe in. Like you've won the lottery. That's what belief will tell you. Like, wow, you've won the lottery. Or conversely, it will tell you that you're completely stupid and hopeless, crazy person. You know, it'll just say you're nothing because you don't have any belief anymore. You know, you need to, but as soon as you believe in it, then again, welcome to the kingdom of belief. You know, and then your mind goes like this, and it's full of beliefs, and it's activated like this constantly. And then you need to step out of belief again like this, and you're calm and cool. And back in the abiding in the isness. So we don't want belief in anything. We want knowing, to know, to abide in. Yet belief is so self-assured, you know, it is so assured of itself, and very arrogant and brisk about insisting that, yeah, you know, you won, congratulations, you all you have to do now to be in light is experience. You know, in other words, you may have an experience of isness at the present moment, and belief will say, congratulations, now all you have to do is believe in it and you'll be enlightened. And so you start believing in it, and then the wheels start to fall off, and you wonder, what happened? I thought I was enlightened. I thought I was almost enlightened. And belief will say, well, you just have to believe in it a little longer and then you'll be enlightened. The problem is you haven't believed in it long enough. And you say, well, I've been believing in it for a long time. And they say, yeah, well, you're almost there. You just have to believe a little stronger. And you know, your life is frittered away. Happens to the best of us, happens to everybody. Belief is very tricky. Very tricky. Which is why, I guess, in various traditions that go through meditation and go through these various stages, the guru, the teacher, the master, whatever you want to call them, you know, will tell a student, you get a glimpse of it, but you're not enlightened. And the student says, what do you mean? I'm not enlightened. I believe I am enlightened. And the teacher will say, well, no, belief is just tricking you, telling you to believe in the experience you had. And the student says, yeah, but if I don't believe in it, you know, it's nothing. I said, no, it's still there. You just experience what is there right now. And you need to go back to it and abide in it and stop believing in it. So we have this trouble. We think and if we don't believe in something, it's not real. See, we're so used to belief, so used to it, that there is this enormous struggle, and we keep getting tricked and frustrated and flustered because we think, oh, but I'm believing in all this stuff. I believe in truth. I believe all this stuff. I believe in I am presence of goodness. I believe in the overlay of unconditional love, all that. But that just actually strengthens belief. And belief says, now you have something to believe in. You see how powerful belief is? And then belief will gradually turn your attention away from that to just very self-destructive situations, and will continue to assault you with all of its tricks, all the while telling you that you're almost enlightened. You just have to keep believing in it. That's, of course, a complete scam, fraud from belief. And it gets us over and over and over and over again. So it bears repeating, continuously bears repeating, that there is this most diabolical and cleverly deceptive bully we call belief that is so tricky. Because it pulls us out of abidance in truth by its eagerness to congratulate us. And say, wow, terrific. Now you have something to believe in. Let's really get going now. So now you can really get going. See, now you have something that really motivates you. That's what it'll say, like that. Give you a pep talk, like, finally opportunity has come, you know. But what you need to do is see through that and say, no, belief is not offering opportunity. It's offering misery. It's abidance in unconditional love that is the answer. It's abiding in how we feel right now that is salvation, not believing in it, not patting ourselves on the back with belief. Belief is ready to pat us on the back and saying congratulations. You've got motivation now, but motivation to what? To wait. All belief wants you to do is wait. Meanwhile, it goes about tearing you to pieces. So if it can get you to wait, that's its purpose, get you to wait. So it will say, congratulations, you know, you now have something to believe in, and you're going to get something even better than this. It'll say, okay, now you know how you feel right now, so therefore you're able to now figure out how to get something better. How to get something better than that. So it'll say, great. I can really work on belief. You can believe in something better. And, you know, poor us. We remain in this spiritual poverty through this giving away the present moment to a future belief, a belief in a future. What we are doesn't need a future. What we are is complete in itself, always. And we continuously give away this holiness to a belief in some greater holiness. And belief will say, yeah, you got a glimpse of it, but you just have to wait for it to get better. There's a waiting period. You got to believe in it. And by believing in it, it is going to become something even greater. It'll become complete. And say, wait a minute. It is complete right now. And belief will say, well, in the future, it's going to be more complete. So you need to get into the future and then wait there for it to be complete, for it to catch up to you. So we project ourselves into the future, and we're there waiting. So basically, all of us are in what we would call the future, waiting for something greater than how we feel right now, greater than eternity, greater than right now. And we're just waiting here in the future. And we're told that we need to work on spirituality and work on belief and believe in it more and do all this stuff. We're trying to pull the present now into the future where we believe that where we are. Because that's the only place we could, you know, believe we are right now. It's in the process of becoming something better. In other words, right now it's not enough. We want something better. We want more complete. Something more complete than perfect completeness. Something more perfect than perfect perfection. Where could that be except in the future? In time. If you want to, you could say you're waiting in the past. But, you know, it's six of one, half a dozen the other, and it's really, we tend to think of progress as something that hasn't yet been accomplished, therefore it can't really be in the past, it's something in the future. So we'll use that we're waiting in the future for something that hasn't yet happened. Like we're waiting for the present to catch up to the future, to catch up to us where we are. And when it does, we think it will be better. So we're all, you know, here waiting in the future, thinking, wow, we're really going to be some really great, you know, and this is the whole collective consciousness of the planet. As we believe we are in for something really good, something really great's going to happen to us. Because we're all waiting here, waiting for it to happen, waiting for the present to catch up to the future. And of course, it never does. It never does. And we, you know, have all sorts of excuses and explanations and to explain, you know, why it hasn't happened yet and what we have to do to make it happen. Ceaselessly, we are working to make it happen. Every generation that comes in, they tell, hey, world, we're here in the future, and we know how to get the past to catch up to the future. Every generation says that. And there are a few of every generation that say, no, wait a minute. This is just the same old, you know, getting fooled again. Every generation thinks it has the way, it has the means to enable the present to catch up to the future, where we all believe we are. We believe we're in the future. We're not. We're right here, right now, really. Except we don't believe that. And so we turn to belief to tell us how we should feel. We say, belief, how does the future feel? And belief gives us all this feeling. Everything we're feeling comes from belief. It doesn't come from how we really feel right now at all. Not at all. And so, as we're waiting, belief tells us this is how you should feel. These are the experiences you should be having. All of this stuff. And this is going to enable you to get the past to come into the future. When it does, we're going to feel better than anything possible. Even better than perfection. And in the meantime, we got all this stuff going on in our mind. Our minds are just constantly saturated with this effort, spiritual effort of all different kinds. We can't sleep. All this stuff is coursing through our brains and minds. Think. How can we get the present to come into the future? How can we get it? How can we seduce it, tempt it, convince it? You know, whatever. We try all sorts of different ways. And none of them work, of course. And we're baffled by it. We're really baffled by existence. Existence seems to be incredibly baffling. Spiritual path means to see what's really going on so you're no longer baffled by it. And you can say, ah, okay, it's just, I see the whole situation very clearly for what it is. And I don't need to keep waiting in the future to feel how I really feel right now. Of course not. But we believe that we're somehow going to feel better. That's just, we think we're going to feel better in the future. The future holds out some promise for something better than how we feel right now. And we assume that must be so. Because we compare the past. We look at the past and say, well, we didn't feel good then at all. So the future must be better. But we're not looking at how we feel right now. We're not aware of how we feel right now. We only assume that the past is correlates to how we feel have felt right now, and that the future is something that's going to make it better. So we simply go from the from memories of the past to belief in the future, overlooking how we feel right now in the present. That is actually what we're doing constantly. But how we felt in the past was exactly the same as how we feel now, because that's just, in the past means those moments where we were, that have passed, where we were waiting in the future. So it's just a chronicle of us waiting in the future. The past is merely the chronicle of all that waiting we've already done. waiting in the future. So we're still waiting in the future. 10 years ago, we were waiting in the future. A million years ago, we were waiting in the future. So nothing's changed. We don't experience right now. We don't experience how we feel right now. When people talk about the now moment, etc., it really means, how do we feel right now? How do we actually really feel right now? Meaning, not how we believe we feel, but how do we actually feel? Free from any belief in how we feel. And we're afraid if we free ourselves from belief of how we feel, we won't feel anything. It'll be like a nothingness, not true. There will be a perfect fullness, a perfect holiness. Not a nothing, not an emptiness, not a nothingness, none of that. Those are also beliefs. The belief in nothingness, the belief in emptiness, those are beliefs. There's no such thing in reality. Reality is completely full. There's no emptiness there. There's no nothingness there. It's utterly full and complete and present. Perfectly, 100%. It's belief. Belief will put us into all sorts of beliefs. Belief in nothingness. Belief in emptiness. Belief in this. And we think, we believe some sort of spiritual condition or in the now, or that's how we feel or whatever. It's not true. Not true. It's simply another belief telling us how it believes we should feel. Telling us how it believes enlightenment is. How it tells us how it believes how we feel right in this moment. If we want to feel how we feel at this moment now, belief will give us what it believes that is like. And we will experience that and believe that we have experienced it, whereas we have not. We have not. There is a feeling, the feeling of right now, how we feel right now, that is beyond belief. And it's not common that anyone abides in that feeling. It's much more common for us to try to feel various beliefs. Beliefs telling us this is how you should feel, this is how enlightenment feels, this is how the now moment feels, this is how we really feel. Belief telling us, we tend to believe in that, whatever it might be, emptiness or nothingness, or, you know, there's all sorts of different ways. Belief has a whole vast array of beliefs on how we should feel and how the now moment feels. None of them are true. None of it is true. So there is that feeling right now, how we really feel, and most of us have felt that at very, maybe subtly, like faintly. It's like brushing against it almost, gently brushing against it. And we say, what is that? What is that? I like that. I really like that. And we feel it, we say, ah, that is what I really want to feel. We know it. We say, oh, that is what I really want to feel. That's my authentic feeling. Okay. And it's different than anything that belief can give us. Belief cannot give us that feeling at all. The truth is, we can abide in that feeling. That is the truth. As long as we don't try to keep trying to give it away. As long as we don't keep believing we're in the future, where we're waiting for that feeling to come into the future, come into belief, implying that it is not perfect right now, implying it can be transformed, changed into something quote-unquote better. That stems from our desire to be prime creator. We believe we can be greater than what we are now, even greater than the prime creator, that we can be the creators of reality. So whatever is right now, we think, well, we can be better than that. So belief tells us, you know, yeah, that's your authentic feeling, but you can be better. In fact, you will be. And so why waste your time? Why waste your time abiding in that which you're going to outgrow anyway? It will tell you that it's something that you're going to outgrow, and that everybody who's waiting in the future is actually in the process of outgrowing it, so that you're lagging behind. You're going to be left behind, ostracized, alienated, separated. It's telling you, oh, if you abide in that, you're separating yourself from everyone else, because everyone else is in the process of growing into something even better. That's why they're in the future, and you're in the present, and you're just separating yourself from that. It'll scare you, throw guilt trips at you. All this bullying stuff is what we're talking about here on this channel, because that is what really helps. That is what truly helps, is bringing up this bullying behavior of belief, vetting the bully, taking a look at how it bullies us, and by doing that, by laughing at it, we gradually lose fear of it. It doesn't intimidate us as much anymore, which is real progress. That is the true progress. And we talk about this with humor and just show how ridiculous it is, the vainglorious, arrogant boasting and threats of belief, telling us this is, all that stuff was funny. It's really funny. So let's not forget to laugh at how ridiculous it really is. And even how terrible it is too is funny, because the remedy is so simple. The remedy is so simple. You just simply do not try to hand over the present right now to belief. That's all. And belief will, of course, throw everything against the wall, hoping something will stick, trying to convince you to hand it over. Hand it over to belief. But what you're really doing is you're stepping into the kingdom of death. But when you do that, you step into the kingdom of death. All the while, belief, of course, praising you that you finally got with the program, and now you're one with all. Everyone else has got with of them, and that you've repudiated separation and all this kind of stuff. It will say all those things, very spiritual sounding stuff, all opposite of truth, ridiculous stuff. It's those that are trying to abide in the future that are trying to separate from reality, not the one who's abiding in reality. Reality is not trying to separate from reality. Reality is not trying to become something different than what it is. So belief is just insane, completely insane, the way it operates. Yet it can seem very convincing, very frightening, very threatening. And so we spend time looking at this so-called threat. We don't spend time so much, throwing out sugar plums and flowers and peace, love, and all this beauty, etc., etc. That won't get the job done. We have to look at the bully, so we can overcome this bully, so we can say no to the bully, so your mind can say, no, I'm not going to project into the future. I'm not going to abide in the future. Abiding in the future is really just waiting for something that will never happen. Eventually you get so tired of waiting, you just say, no, I'm not going to do that anymore. And belief will absolutely berate you. It will absolutely berate you. I've been through that many times. And the intimidation is much less now than before. But really, when you stand up to belief, it really berates you. And we'll try every trick in the book to make you feel scared and guilty. That somehow you are trying to, separate yourself from the oneness. That abiding in the oneness is somehow an attempt to separate from it. Saying, well, everyone is growing into a new oneness, and you're separating yourself from that new oneness. Yeah. You say, well, what's happening to the oneness that is right now? And belief says, that's going to be superseded. It'll be enfolded into the whole thing. It'll be part of it. It makes all these excuses and stuff. So the shocking truth is that our prayers, our guidance, I've seen that it's all coming from belief, because we're appealing to belief. But when we ask for help, we're asking help of belief, for the most part. For the most part, that is what we do. And belief will give us guidance. Absolutely, belief gives us guidance. It gives us everything we ask of belief. It will respond in some fashion. And belief that it is giving us guidance, the right guidance, and answering our prayers in the right way, and guiding our life, and everything we pray, belief believes that it can respond and do all of that. But what it's really doing is simply deceiving and lying and insisting that we keep waiting here in the future for the present to so-called come into the future, grow into the future, move into the future, where it's supposedly going to transcend what it is and become better. This is the religion of madness. This is a belief system that is completely insane. And so as we keep on looking at this, you know, we start out, our minds, you know, are like, I like this. It's just total flawless, you know, confusion and doubt. And we're just tormented, you know, tormented by all these complexities. And then we gradually, we look at it, fades away like this until, you know, we have this no confusion here. Very clear. And I'm just testifying to this. There are times right now where I'm able to just see the utter simplicity of the situation. And just say, that's a piece of cake. And not feel any intimidation, really, from belief. There are times where that clicks in. And you see. And then there are times when then that, you know, gets a little fuzzy. But the overall trend is toward that. Coming out of, you know, extreme intimidation now to the point where the tides have turned. The tides have definitely turned. Tide has turned. You can turn the tide around. That is what satsang and inquiry is for. Is to turn that tide. So keep at it. Keep at it. It may seem a tall effort to turn the tide, but the more you focus, the more intense and the more determined and the more pressures on you, realize, hey, the future is waiting in the future is a terrible option. You get into it. And you find that you're able to turn the tide, and belief cannot bully you nearly like it used to. And then the progress is on your side. So stay with it. Stay with the truth, and the truth will stay with you. All right. Very great. That's it for this video.